Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, ladies and gentlemen, now we are going to start the third day's fourth panel discussion. And I'm sure for the last 2.5 days you have been listening to very good speeches, discussions by the honorable guests. This session is also very important because it's current as well as the theme is relevant to our development agenda. The title of this discussion is Industrial Development, Job Creation, Special Economic Zones and Urban Development. We are very honored here that this session is going to be chaired by Naeem Zamindar, Chairman, Board of Investment, and I would like to request him to please come on stage. Next, I would like to request Dr. Shahid Rashid, who is the Executive Director, Center of Excellence, CPEC Center at PIDE. We have also requested Dr. Shahid Rashid to be the moderator of this session, although he is a panelist himself, but we have requested him to please manage the session, which will be concluded then by the speech by the chairperson. In the list of panelists, I would like to first of all call Dr. Tariq Banuri, Sitara Imtiaz, Executive Director, Global Change Impact Studies Center, Islamabad. Next, Ma'am Anjum Asad Amin, Additional Secretary, Ministry of Commerce, with a very long history of association with trade and industry. Please come. The next is Professor Dr. Aliya H. Khan, former Dean, Social Sciences, Qaid-e-Azam University, Islamabad. The next is Dr. Ijaz Shafi Gilani from Gallup, Pakistan, and I'm somebody informed me that he's in the way, so he'll join. Last, we have Mr. Azhar Zia-ur-Rehman, who's Governance Assurance, Cybersecurity, BIM, and IT Executive. So we have a very distinguished panel now, and I would like to request Dr. Shahid Rashid to please proceed from here. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Khalid. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. To open the session, the opening speech is myself, so let me deliver it first and then we'll continue with the rest of the session. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Honorable Chairman of the session, Mr. Naeem Zamindar sir. Respected panelists, Dr. Tariq Banuri, Dr. Aliya Khan, Ms. Anjum Asad Amin, Mr. Ijaz Shafi Gilani, Mr. Azhar Zia-ur-Rehman, students and faculty, ladies and gentlemen, assalamu alaikum and a very good afternoon. It's an immense pleasure for me to talk to you at this wonderful forum of the 33rd Annual General Meeting and Conference of the Pakistan Institute of Pakistan Society of Development Economists. It's the fourth panel session of the conference, and the topic of this session is industrial development, job creation, special economic zones, and urban development. This topic approaches the key and interconnected aspects associated with the inclusive and sustainable growth of any economy. For instance, industrial development is mandatory to provide the needed products in economy of scale and scope for rapidly growing population of the country like Pakistan, with simultaneous contribution to import substitution and export promotion. The industrial development also creates new jobs, much needed in the country where 1.5 million workforce join the job seekers pool every year. Special economic zone could be a vehicle to support industrial development, especially in developing countries where issues regarding capital, technology, and doing business prevail. And it is often not possible to improve the overall landscape of existing industrial sector throughout the country at a glance, and rather few pilot zones could be developed with factor, transactional, and fiscal advantages to attract investment, technology, global enterprises, and export orders. The success of SEZs and industrial development also needs a sustainable urban ecosystem within and around these, so that beside work, an environment-friendly socio-economic environment could be available to the workforce and citizens of the country at large. My dear fellows, Pakistan is primarily an agriculture-based economy, but since last 50 years, the direct contribution of agriculture to GDP has been dropped from 60% to a current low level of 20%. However, it is still accommodating 50% of the employed workforce and supporting manufacturing and service sectors to the level of their 60% contribution to GDP. To regain the hallmark of agriculture sector, agricultural modernization is required from seed to produce for current and future food security of the country, for which full play needs to be given to develop agro-value-adding special economic zones, having backward and forward linkages with research and technology institutions and export value chains, respectively. Similarly, dairy and livestock value-added industry has a lot of potential to be capitalized. Industrial sector in Pakistan is contributing 21% of GDP, which is lacking behind the regional countries. Its contribution to employment is around 40%. Keeping in view the sector-wise contribution of foreign direct investment, it is predominantly directed towards oil and gas, power and communication. Although measuring FDI across sectors by dollar value alone can be misleading, there is corroborating concern in the decline of manufacturing value added, which fell from 19% in 2005 to 13% in 2015. To strengthen the manufacturing value adding, role of special economic zones is important. For instance, around 3,500 SEZs have been established in 135 countries, provided more than 70 million direct jobs, and accounted for $500 billion of trade-related value added within these zones. China alone leveraged 5 SEZs since 1980, contributed 22% to GDP, attracted 46% of its FDI, and exported 60% products. Pakistan is relatively a new entrant to embrace the prospects of SEZs. However, there exists a substantial room for development of new SEZs across the country, especially under the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor, to attract FDI and technology, assess global markets and create new jobs, support local industry through its linkages with SEZs. The success of these zones is associated with state-of-the-art development of hard and soft infrastructure within these SEZs based on the prevailing endowments-based clusters suitable to compete its produce in the global markets. Also, effective branding and rigorous marketing of these SEZs to the prospective investors, including the overseas Pakistanis, could be helpful. Ladies and gentlemen, besides the conventional ways of development, product diversification could be focused for expansion of industrial base. In this regard, innovation-driven developments needs to be followed by encouraging entrepreneurship and investment support to startups. Cyber economy could be developed and promoted based on the foundation of information communication technology infrastructure already in use. Modern infrastructure networks, including comprehensive transport system, energy system, and water management system, are important foundations. Focus on the untapped blue economy is required by developing the marine and seafood industries at commercial level and develop coastal tourism. Also, green and environmentally friendly industries could be promoted for sustainability. High priority needs to be given to employment generation by establishing accessible and effective job seekers centers. Ladies and gentlemen, in the end, I would like to share that Pakistan has immense economic potential, and according to recent report by PricewaterhouseCoopers, Pakistan is projected to become the world's 20th largest economy by 2030. To transform the projection into reality, I would like to share the saying of Mahathir Muhammad that the key to the transformation that occurred in Malaysia was a change in mindset that created unity. We also need a constructive mindset to build positive dreams and realize it accordingly. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now I would like to request my next panelist to share his valuable thoughts, Dr. Tariq Banuri.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Is somebody going to put up the PowerPoint? When I was invited to give this talk, I did mention that this is something on which I haven't really done any empirical work, so I will have to try to provide, raise some questions rather than give you some answers. And in order to raise those questions, I thought it would be useful to actually revisit an old literature that was quite popular in Pakistan's first growth wave in the 1950s and 60s. This is the growth literature on growth poles, which is essentially a Schumpeterian approach to development. And I just want to walk us through it and then come up with a few questions, and hopefully at the end, when we have a discussion, we will come back to some of those questions. Can people read this? So first of all, let me just go back to Schumpeter. Schumpeter did one of the early and very pioneering work on economic development. His idea, basically, the main idea that he gave was about development as a discontinuous activity. It's not like a, you see, development is not like just an expansion. It's not a linear problem of, you know, just an increase in static equilibrium. It's a discontinuous disruptive activity. And so he gave a number of examples about how the disruption takes place. Put this quote, growth does not appear everywhere and all at once. It appears in points of development, development poles, with variable intensities. It spreads along different channels, diverse channels, with various terminal effects, etc., etc. So it's not, one has to see, understand development as a very disruptive and discontinuous process. That was kind of one of the things that Schumpeter taught us. His ideas were then developed by François Perrou, a French economist writing in the 1950s, in which he also tried to come up with this idea of growth centers, from which, you know, so you have growth centers from which you have centrifugal forces and centripetal forces. Some things attract, some things repel, and that's how growth takes place. Now, his notion of growth poles was that if you think about the idea of growth, his notion is that, you see, growth is a kind of a clustering process. That means there is something which actually is driving that growth. And so you create a pole, the pole begins to attract and almost like begins to attract investment, and then it begins to grow. And so it's almost like a hub and spokes kind of a model, that you have different things that emerge as hubs and then they begin to grow. I can give you one example of a global nature, which is that even if you look at the global process of growth, starting with the Industrial Revolution, you can see that it's a growth pole driven process, right? First England, Holland, Germany, and then Europe kind of being dragged behind it. And then later on, when Japan comes in, and Japan is followed by the Asian tigers, so the tigers are pulled behind Japan, and behind the Asian tigers then come China, and now China is pulling a lot of countries behind it. And there's some kind of a geographical contiguity, but there's also contiguity within each of the regions. So, so he both Schumpeter and Peru were trying to understand the dynamics of this process. The thing that they emphasized was the role played by large corporations, which dominate the market. Today, in the current literature, we sometimes use the word value chains to describe this process. If you think about people know what a value chain literature is, right? So when you try to understand the nature of the economy, you look at the linkages between different sectors, right? So if you look at cotton, so you go from the cotton producer to the ginner to the spinner to the weaver to then finishing textiles and then garments and marketing. And so this is an entire chain which produces value. The problem in different chains is that each of those chains is then driven by a particular pole. So if you contrast, for instance, you look at automobiles as one example and you look at textiles as another example. Automobiles is controlled by the car producers, by General Motors and Toyota and Mercedes and so forth. They are the ones who control it. So it's really at the beginning end of the chain. But textiles is controlled by the retailers, by Walmart and H&M and JCPenney and so on and so forth, the big retailers. And that's because that is where a lot of the surplus rents come in. And then these things begin to drive innovation, they begin to, you know, the spillover effects begin to take place, etc. So at that time, when Schumpeter and Peru were writing, their idea was that the large organizations are the ones which dominate the industry, they have control of resources, they have control of technology, and they also have strong backward and forward linkages which then spill over into other industries. And so the growth process takes place through these poles, through which not only do they rise, but they actually pull a lot of the other industries, firms and industries behind them. There are a number of other definitions. I don't think I want to stay with them, but there are a number of things which people have raised, that the purpose, the use of infrastructure is for existing private investment to encourage spillovers, that you understand that what you are trying to do in terms of policy is not to promote a particular industry, but to promote the spillover from one industry to the other, from one firm to the other. And that's where the development corridors, special economic zones, agglomeration economies, these things come in. They generally always focus on some existing resource which is already a revenue producer, which is already a revenue. So you might think about minerals as a resource, or you might think about sort of a cotton industry around which you will build a whole sector. Or there are some sectors in which you invest so that, because you think that there is a comparative advantage and this will actually create some revenues for you. And this last point is very important, that projects are not oriented towards addressing market failures, but around capitalizing and strengthening opportunities that already exist in the economy. So you know that there are opportunities. What you're trying to do is to capitalize upon those opportunities, right? And that's where some of these synergies come in. One very important element in this is the notion of leading firms and leading industries. And you basically ask, you know, that within, what are the leading industries? So I've already mentioned, like, for instance, this theory was used in France, Switzerland, Italy, as a conscious strategy for economic development. And they focused on automotive sectors, steel sectors. This is the same thing in China and in Korea, that you sort of, they focused on heavy industry as the driving sector. Pakistan used it, textiles as kind of the driving sector. So then there are some features of the leading industry, and then within the leading industry, there are some features of the leading firm, which I think need to be identified. There are other number of other issues. One set of controversies You remember, this was actually a very important theory in Pakistan's early development, and some people say that we lost Bangladesh because of this idea of the regional poles, that we said focus on West Pakistan and ignore East Pakistan. And this idea of the dominance region and the subordinate region became very central. And you know, these are some controversial ideas, but the idea mainly was polarization between the dominant, the driving, the leading sector and the lagging sector. And the leading and lagging sectors had a number of characteristics which I've tried to list over here. Now, the idea of the growth poles was not initially regional. It was actually industry which is driving the system. What Boudeville, another French economist, did was to convert it to a region. And they also converted to the urban economics, that you know, you actually create a growth pole, or you see a growth pole, and then it will begin to attract a lot of investment around it. One way you can think about it is, if you think of some kind of a three-dimensional diagram in which you have kind of high levels of investment, high levels of property values, high level of revenues in one areas, and then you have a slope which goes, which means that it is kind of attracting investments and revenues around it. Another way you could think about it is that you can think of Islamabad as a growth pole, and you go out from Islamabad and you notice that the property around Islamabad now is very highly valued, not because it produces more, but because it is being pulled by the growth pole of Islamabad. Do you understand? That its productivity is very low, but Islamabad's effect on the surrounding property is that all of this is raising prices. So that's kind of the philosophy of the growth pole theory. What happened? So let me just quickly finish. There are a number of externalities. Why do spillovers happen? Externalities within firms, within industries, within the region. We talk about some of those things. The important thing is that this was a very popular theory in the 50s and 60s. Then it fell out of favor because of a number of reasons, East Pakistan being one of them. But in other places also, that people felt that there were alternative examples, and people did began to question it. It has now started to come back into focus, largely because of the Chinese example. Because in China, the special economic zones were successful, as opposed to most other countries where they were not really successful. So I've kind of gone over some of the failure and controversy. Now, the question that I want to raise to you is, let's think about some of these questions. The first question is that we are setting up the special economic zones. Will they actually deliver on their promise? What is the history? And I would like us economists to actually look at the history and say, where have they succeeded, where have they failed? Our experience in the 1950s and 60s is not very salutary, but we can learn a little bit from the Chinese example, etc. Number two, what is the revenue generating source that we are talking about in these special economic zones? You put a special economic zone in the middle of nowhere, is it actually going to do anything? What is it that you're trying to contribute to it? Number three, this is the last slide, don't worry. Are there potentially dynamic industries and firms which can be placed there, which can become those growth poles to draw the rest of the investment there? Let me give you an example. In Taxila and Hatar, we set up these industrial estates with heavy industrial complex, heavy mechanical complex. Nothing happened. You know, we did it for like 30 or 40 years. Now the question is, why is it that this time it's going to be different? You have to answer some of these questions in order for us to be able to move forward. Number four, is there a source of trade competitiveness that we are talking about? If you are producing only for domestic consumption, it is actually not going to be a major growth pole. So we need to ask ourselves, is there a trade competitiveness component that we can put into those special economic zones? And finally, perhaps most importantly, I should have started with this, what are the gaps that policy can fill? In other words, if you are creating special economic zones, you think it will lead to a growth process, what is it that is stopping it? Should policy focus on financing? Should it focus on regulation? Should it focus on capacity building? Should it focus on information, on infrastructure? What is it that the capacity will do? Ladies and gentlemen, these are only a few questions. I don't think that we have the settled answers on special economic zones. I think there's a lot more work to be done. And if we are going to make this round successful, we need the economics community to start looking at them. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Dr. Tariq Banuri sahab, for enlightening us with the development, growth, and SEZs. Our next speaker is Ms. Anjum Asad Amin. Madam, kindly, if you could enlighten us with your presentation.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for having me here. It's indeed an honor to be a panelist with very learned speakers and in the kind of gathering. I have been associated with PIDE as a visiting faculty member, and I've done 3 semesters with the master's program in past 5 years, but not in the recent past. And it's really nice to be re-engaging with the PIDE. So today I'll be talking about more of experiences and the practices of trade and its correlation with industrialization and the context on the exports and how industrialization is important and it provides base for export promotion. Just having a look at the recent data, we can simply say that our industrial share of industry in our total GDP has been 20% consistently during 2012, 13, and 13, 14, and it has rather declined over the next few years. Right. Past 5 years, contribution of industry in the GDP has been 20, 20, 19%, 18%, and declined to 18% further. It has not enhanced. That's the first scenario from where it will lead, how its role can be defined in the promotion or the promotion of exports or in the trade in a big way. What has been the growth of industrial sector? It has been 4%, 5%, minus 1%, and 6.8% at the maximum in 2016 and 17. I mean, it has been dwindling between 4% to 7% in the past 5 years, with one exception that it went negative 1.5% in 2015 and 16. Now, how do we correlate industry with the trade? Of course, trade and exports, it needs a strong production base. And we know that the high value goods are industrial goods rather than the agriculture producers. These are processed goods, these are intermediate goods, which are basically industrial goods, and it depends how much industry, how strong industrial base we have in our country. Our goods have to be competitive, goods have to be efficient, we have to be innovative to be able to perform in trade and in order to export. Our exports have been declining past many years, with an exception of this year. The trade gap or the deficit is 30 billion, exports are almost 20, imports are almost 50. There are many questions, why the huge gap and why the gap is increasing past many years, why we have not been able to bridge the gap. There are many tools, as I mentioned. First and the foremost is our production base, agro-based industry, then competitiveness and efficiency. But there's another bigger tool that we use to promote our exports, and we use to create a caveat where we support each other's, we support trading between 2 bilateral partners, and that is called free trade agreements. We have contracted free trade agreements with a number of countries, and I would like to, slides thi meri, wo kindly slides dikha rahi hai? No, not these slides. No, no. These are the slides? Oh, okay. Okay, so these are not the right slides, perhaps. Yeah, it does show the trend, but not very clearly. But I can just explain the slides. For example, having contracted an FTA with China in 2005 and 6, free trade agreement with China, wherein we extended concessions on 5,000 products to China, and China extended concessions to Pakistan in 7,000 products. That was 10 or 12 years before. Where we are now, our exports to China are 1.5 billion. Our imports from China are 14.1 billion today. The gap is of $13 billion. The year we contracted our FTA, signed our FTA, the gap was only $3 billion. A reason. And the same applies to our FTA with Malaysia. The same is the observation for FTA with Sri Lanka, Indonesia, and Thailand. One of the major reasons that I would attribute is lack of industrial base to be able to gauge and exploit the opportunity provided by the concessional market access to these countries. 5,000 products jiski humko, 7,000 products jiski China ne hume access di hai, we hardly performed. The reason being that we did not have the capacity to export. We did not produce these products. And despite lapse of 10 years, we did not start to produce these products, which were futuristic products. And 2005 and 6, government of Pakistan perceived that we'll have the capacity to produce and export these products, for which we did not create industrial base. So relating it to the SEZs, we are looking forward to be able to set up such industries through which we'll be able to use the potential provided by the market access by all our bilateral partners with whom we have contracted free trade agreements. We are in process of contracting and negotiating free trade agreements with a number of other countries, especially Thailand in a big way, but what is a matter of concern is that we hardly have any coordination in a big way with many players who need to provide us inputs and the policy insight for the future. For example, Agriculture Ministry, Ministry of Agriculture, Ministry of Industries, FBR, Board of Investment. It's a big question whether any study or have been undertaken or any concern have been gauged or incorporated to see whatever we have contracted and agreed in our FTAs for the future 10 years, are we setting up the industry of those products for which there's an existing market access, there are lower duties? FTA is actually tariff optimization. And tariff optimization means, for example, if country A is producing something for $10 and the country B is producing something for $15, we have offered concession to country B that despite producing the product for $15, we provide them we provide them concession and we buy the product at $10. And to the other country, we impose duties. And the product would cost $12. And that means we are importing from the country who is producing $15 a product rather than from the country who is producing at $10 a product. So this is a game. And tariff is a string. And the commodities are like puppets. And we are playing strings. And our puppets are dancing with the tariff that we are imposing. And it's not that simple. It's very intricate subject. It has hundreds of variables. It is futuristic, and it is very dynamic. So I would urge the audience, learned scholars, our students of economics, to get into the thoughts of how to handle this dynamics in which we are far behind, we are lagging behind in expertise, experience, and in our system. We are trying to compete with the countries who have evolved excellent systems in the form of data, in the form of analysis, in the form of techniques. And we can't beat them. They are ahead of us. So that's my question, very open question to the audience and to all the learning panelists, to ponder on that, and especially to the Board of Investment and regarding SCCs, do we have any correlation of the products that we are promoting to be set up and to be manufactured in the future year? Do they reflect upon the FTAs that we have contracted? And would we be able to manufacture efficiently at par with those from where we are importing our intermediate goods, which form 51% of our import bill? Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks, Ms. Anjum Asad Amin, for sharing your experiences about the practices of trade, industrialization, and exports. Our next panelist is Dr. Aliya Khan.
I would like to take this opportunity to thank PSDE, PIDE, for giving me an opportunity to share my thoughts on what I call the human face of CPEC. Last year, I delivered a panel address on labor market dynamics and CPEC, and this year, I'm going to present some ideas related to job creation in SEZs based on empirical evidence that has been documented in the literature. I would also like this to take this opportunity to acknowledge the presence of my teacher, my mentor, Professor Mangla, in the audience. It is he who set me on the path of economic inquiry. I did my master's thesis with him, and on Granger-Sims causality in the days where we could not even interact with the computer. It was all through punching cards. Thank you, sir. I am here because of you, of all my teachers. Next, please. Okay. The panelists before me have given you theory. And now, with all that theoretical background, let's see what the evidence speaks about SEZs. There's no doubting the fact that SEZs are one component of an overall growth strategy. They cannot be the sole mover and shaker of a growth strategy. So they have to be embedded in a growth strategy. They are set up to develop and diversify exports and to create jobs and pilot new policies and approaches. So SEZs are very experimental in their philosophy. However, the experience shows that while zones have been effective in addressing growth and development, they have not been uniformly successful. So to presume that if we have SEZs, they are definitely going to be successful is not the rational way of looking at SEZs. We have to make them successful. G, next. Okay, this is just definitional. I'm not going to go over it. However, one point stands out, that they are mostly engaged in labor-intensive production and labor intensive, such as apparel, textiles, electrical, and electronic goods. So this, now you can link this to the query raised by Madam Anjum as to whether really these are the sectors in which Pakistan has an advantage in terms of SEZ production, because this is what the worldwide evidence shows, that these sectors are really promoted in the SEZs. Next. Obviously, the topic given to me should reflect the emphasis of the productivity of the workforce and labor management practices. Now, being a labor economist and having worked on labor issues of labor law reform as well, I would like to speak out that SEZs are also quite notoriously famous for their labor mismanagement practices. So that is a cautionary note. We have to look out for that. And wherever the international labor standards have been sort of adhered to, SEZs do present a more human face of that development. Third point is very important. Now, as we are going into the modalities of CPEC, people are questioning, is it going to be our labor that is going to work in the SEZs? Is it going to be Chinese labor? So this point addresses that the foreign worker employment regime should be transparent, and it should largely discourage excessive dependence on foreign workers at the expense of domestic ones. This is not something that I have written. This is coming directly from the literature. So we need to be careful that we need to utilize and absorb as much of the Pakistani local labor force in our SEZs as possible. Next. Okay. What have been the labor-related or the job-related issues that have been flagged in terms of SEZs? Gender, and I have a later slide on that. Up to almost 90% of employment in developing country SEZs has been of women. Are we going to follow the same pattern? Are we going to assure that the 50% population of Pakistan becomes an important labor asset for these SEZs? But because of women being excessively employed and labor regimes being discriminatory also, women have sometimes not really benefited from their employment. So it is in that context that if we provide female employment, it should adhere to labor standards also. Wage levels, SEZs are also known for paying less than the minimum wages to workers just to cap the cost of production. So we have to be cautious about that. Worker rights, working conditions, environmental impacts, of which I was just talking to Professor Tariq Banuri that, you know, has there been any engagement, you know, on environmental standards? And he said that he's going to start looking into this aspect, because it's very important that environmental standards are adhered to. Okay, this is the second slide is the activist in me, and it says that, you know, whatever labor organization which is okay in the form of trade unions, they should be on board. Otherwise, if there are grievances of workers working in SEZs, it is not going to have a very healthy impact, you know, on the worker rights persona of Pakistan, which is also very important in terms of GSP plus now. Pakistan is a signatory to 27 it has to adhere to 27 conventions on labor rights and human rights to get GSP plus preferences. So it's in line with that. Next. Okay. SEZs and job creation is also a very contested issue, because are SEZs just used as pressure valves. That is, there is a pressure of unemployment, so let's plug the pressure by pushing the workforce into SEZs, just as we think that, you know, export of rough labor and unskilled labor addresses unemployment in Pakistan. Or should we be using SEZs for a labor reform agenda, which, you know, enhances the productivity of labor and engages them in productive employment? So this is to be taken note of. And also that SEZ development should be couched in the larger trade and investment strategy of a country. And this is exactly what Madam Anjum was pointing to, that the trade and investment imperatives of Pakistan should be very well connected with SEZ development also. So what do you want me to do? Stop?
No, 1 minute.
I might as well say goodbye, because 1 minute is absolutely not sufficient anyway. Okay. 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 Next. Next. You can skip this slide. Okay. Okay. This is what I was pointing to, that there is a feminization of work in SEZs for which empirical evidence suggests that the type of production that is undertaken in SEZs is capable of absorbing women workers. I mean, not to say that you know, there are different types of productions which can absorb women only, but it is very conducive to the work that women traditionally have done in the manufacturing sector all over the world. Next. Okay. I've really cut it short now. This is the list of the special economic zones under CPEC. Nowshera, Dhabeji, Bostan, Faisalabad, Islamabad, the near Port Qasim, Mirpur AJK, Mohammad Marble City, and another one in Gilgit Baltistan. And work has just started. So next. Now, the point about job creation is that look at the sectors that have been identified for the Rashakai Nowshera economic zone: fruit, food packaging, textile stitching, and knitting. Now, I think whatever all of us have been saying since the beginning of this panel is that we need to now put all the theory, all the empirical evidence with this plan for special economic zone development in Pakistan under CPEC and see how we can leverage the theory and the empirical evidence to get the most from job creation under these SEZs. So now the feminization of work in SEZs issue that I was pointing out, I mean, this could become a model for employing women workers, because traditionally women have been employed in the textile sector in Pakistan. It is export oriented. And fruit and food packaging is another export-oriented sector that has been flagged as being a very beneficial sector for Pakistan in terms of tapping the market access, but we have not really leveraged it for the purpose that it can be leveraged for. So I'm sorry to the students, I would have liked to interact with you more, but because of time constraints, however, my presentation will be available with PIDE, and you're most welcome to use it for developing future research topics for your MPhil and PhD theses, because even if we don't have sufficient data for Pakistan on SEZs at the moment, there is a lot of data available globally on SEZs for you to start testing hypotheses relating to job creation in SEZs and other aspects of SEZs. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Aliya Khan, for sharing your valuable thoughts about job creation in SEZs. Our next presenter is Mr. Ijaz Shafi Gilani.
Bismillahir Rahman Rahim. Thank you very much for the invitation. मुझे लगता है वैसे कि audience में कोई ऐसा नहीं है जो उर्दू ना समझता हो. आज मालूम नहीं हो सकता है आप थोड़ी सी आम वो बहुत कोई है हो सकता है डॉक्टर साहब ना समझते हों. इसमें पहले बहुत मरतबा मुझे आने का इत्तफाक हुआ है. बहुत से ऐसे चेहरे नज़र आते थे कि जो उर्दू नहीं समझते थे, लेकिन आज मुझे आपकी खुशकिस्मती है शायद या बदकिस्मती है, और हो सकता है कि यही पाकिस्तान में एक टर्निंग पेज हो. हो सकता है कि पाकिस्तान की इकोनॉमिक डेवलपमेंट में और जिस मसले में हम गुफ्तगू कर रहे हैं यही एक अर्निंग टर्निंग पेज हो कि इस महफ पाकिस्तान की इस महफिल में पाकिस्तानी जबान मैं खुद तो चूंकि डेवलपमेंट इकोनॉमिस्ट नहीं हूँ, पॉलिटिकल साइंस आईआर में डिग्री है, कुछ बहुत से दोस्तों के साथ गाहे बगाहे काम करने का मौका मिलता रहा है, इसलिए मेरे लिए बहुत अच्छा था जब डॉक्टर साहब ने चंद दिन पहले मुझे भी इसमें शामिल कर लिया. तो मैं शुक्रिया इसलिए कर रहा हूँ कि ये 5-6 दिन मैं बहुत कोशिश की कि जो कुछ है वो पढ़ लूँ. ये बिल्कुल सच बता रहा हूँ. इसलिए मैं पाकिस्तान इकोनॉमिक्स पे जितनी मुझे टेक्स्ट बुक्स मिली, अकबर जैदी साहब की मिली, डॉक्टर अमजद ख्वाजा साहब की मिली और चीज़ें मिली, एक तो मैंने वो काफ़ी गौर से देख के उसमें जो इंडस्ट्रियलाइजेशन का या इंडस्ट्री का चैप्टर था वो देखा. दूसरा मैंने जो डेवलपमेंट प्लान से हमारे ख़ास तौर से विजन 2025 वो देखा, और जो मिड टर्म डेवलपमेंट प्लान फ्रेमवर्क उससे पहले आया था वो देखा. कुछ मैंने ये भी देखने की कोशिश की कि ये जो वर्ल्ड वाइड इस पे क्या, आजकल चूंकि वो जेब वाला ट्यूटर बहुत मदद दे देता है तो इसलिए मैं उस ट्यूटर से काफ़ी ये देखने की कोशिश की कि वर्ल्ड वाइड क्या डिस्कशन है इंडस्ट्रियलाइजेशन पे, एसईजीज पे. तो एक और वजह से जिस वजह से इन्होंने मुझे बुला भी लिया कि मैं सीपैक पे पिछले 2 साल से काफ़ी दिलचस्पी है, अगर डेवलपमेंट इकोनॉमिस्ट नहीं हूँ लेकिन सीपैक पे इंटरनेशनल रिलेशंस पॉलिटिकल साइंस वगैरह की वजह से दिलचस्पी है. तो इसलिए मैंने वर्ल्ड वाइड भी ये चीज़ें देखी कि इस पर क्या डिस्कशन है, एसईजीज पे कम और इंडस्ट्रियलाइजेशन पे ज़्यादा. और आहिस्ता आहिस्ता वैसे मैं यानी कल उस पर भी आ गया कि लाहौर स्कूल ऑफ इकोनॉमिक्स ने भी कोई कॉन्फ्रेंस इस पर करवाई थी 2015 में, और वो मुझे उससे पहले मैंने अपने लिए वैसे एक प्रेजेंटेशन ये बनाई हुई थी पीछे जो हमारे नॉर्मल, लेकिन वो पढ़ने के बाद मुझे ख्याल हुआ कि मुझे ये नहीं करनी चाहिए, मुझे ये नहीं करनी चाहिए क्योंकि इससे बहुत बेहतर काम वो 2 साल पहले कर चुके हैं. क्योंकि मैंने जब थोड़ा बहुत वो पढ़ना शुरू किया तो पहली तो मेरी डिस्कवरी ये थी कि चूंकि पाकिस्तान में पाकिस्तान इकोनॉमिक्स पढ़ाई नहीं जाती इसलिए वो टेक्स्ट बुक्स भी बहुत कमज़ोर हैं. तो मैंने डॉक्टर साहब से पूछा था कि आप ये जो हम मास्टर्स करते हैं और बैचलर्स करते हैं और एमफिल करते हैं और पीएचडी का भी कोर्स कर लें तो उसमें पाकिस्तान इकोनॉमिक्स के कुल कितने कोर्स होते हैं. तो शायद 2 या 3 50-60 कोर्सेज में होते हैं जी. तो उससे भी डॉक्टर साहब कह रहे हैं कि यतीम सा कोर्स होता है. इसलिए तो मैं अपना टाइम रन आउट ना कर दूं, लेकिन इस वक्त भी बैठे हुए मैंने ज़्यादा यानी मेरी अकल ने भी सीखा काफ़ी कुछ. डॉक्टर तारिक बनूरी पुरानी दोस्त हैं शुम पीटर से, और फ्रेंच नाम भूल गया मैं उसके बाद, लेकिन और लेकिन मेरे दिल पे ज़्यादा असर हुआ. आई थिंक माई हार्ट लर्न मोर देन माई हेड. और वो ये कि एक चीज़ मैंने इसमें वैसे जो सेंसस ऑफ इकोनॉमिक्स अपनी इस चंद दिन की सर्च में جو سینسس آف اکنامکس لاسٹ ہمارے یہاں دو ہی ملک میں ہوئی ہیں, ایک مرتبہ 88 میں اسٹیبلشمنٹ اور ایک مرتبہ 2005 میں, اس میں مینوفیکچرنگ یونٹس 583,000 لکھے ہوئے تھے. میں کافی اس کا بریک ڈاؤن وغیرہ بھی دیکھا کہ وہ پروونسز میں کیسی ہیں اور اس کی باقی سارے سیکٹرز میں کیسی ہیں اور سائز میں کیسی ہیں, اور اسی طرح سے سینسس فار مینوفیکچرنگ انڈسٹریز وہ بھی لاسٹ 2005 ہی کی تھی, جس میں کوئی 7,000 یونٹس ایسے ہیں کہ جن پہ بہت ڈیٹیل سے انفارمیشن حاصل کی گئی. تو اس 583,000 میں تو البتہ 45,000 وہ لسٹڈ ہیں کہ جو پاکستانی دیہات میں ہیں. یہ بھی مجھے اردو میں بولنے کی اس لیے بھی خواہش ہوئی, اور جو میں کہہ رہا ہوں کہ دل پہ میرے اثر ہوا اس محفل کو سن کے ابھی, وہ یہ کہ 45,000 تو جنہیں ہم نے مینوفیکچرنگ لسٹ کیا ہوا ہے, اور یہ انڈسٹری سے فرق ہے چونکہ انڈسٹری میں مائننگ بھی شامل ہو جاتی ہے. تو اس 583,000 2005 کی فگر میں 45% تو دیہات میں ہیں, اور باقی جو 55% ہیں اس میں سے بھی ایک سبسٹینشیل حصہ اسمال ٹاؤنز میں لسٹڈ ہے. اس میں لیکن صرف 3% وہ ہیں کہ جو یہ کہتے ہیں کہ وہ 10 سے زیادہ امپلائی کرتے ہیں آف دی انٹائر 583,000. اس کا مطلب یہ ہے کہ پاکستان میں یہ جس انڈسٹری کی ہم بات کر رہے ہیں اور جس اس کی جو بیسک اناٹمی ہے, اس بیسک اناٹمی میں تو کچھ میرا خیال ہے انگریزی کی وجہ سے ہم بھول جاتے ہیں, کیونکہ وہ جو 45,000 اس میں سے 68% پنجاب میں ہیں. تو اس کے لیے تو میرا خیال ہے جیسے مجھے بھی اردو کے علاوہ پنجابی بھی آنی چاہیے پھر. کیونکہ ہم نے یعنی کہاں انڈسٹری کرنی ہے اور کہاں مینوفیکچرنگ کرنی ہے. آخر 207 million لوگ ہیں, پری میچورلی ڈی انڈسٹریلائزڈ کنٹری. وہ شاید ہمارے لیے تھیوریٹیکلی پرابلم میں شاید نمبر ون ہو. دوسرا, میں نے اس ڈسکشن میں بھی دیکھا اور زیادہ مجھے خوشی ہوئی, میں اس کے بعد میں نے اس لیے کہا کہ مجھے یہ بہت اچھی لگی ہے, جو لاہور اسکول آف اکنامکس کی کانفرنس تھی لیکن 2.5 سال پہلے تھی, مارچ 2015 میں. اس میں 13 papers تھے اور 13 papers ہر ایک مجھے پسند آیا. میں نسبتاً کریٹیکل بھی ہوں, 45 سال 50 سال اسٹوڈنٹس کے پیپرز مارک کرنے کے بعد آدمی کافی کریٹیکل ہو جاتا ہے. میں 1971 میں یونیورسٹی میں پڑھانا شروع کیا تھا تو اس لیے میں کریٹیکل ہوں, لیکن یہ بہت اچھا تھا. نہ صرف اچھا تھا بلکہ اس میں شروع میں ہی مجھے اندازہ ہو گیا کہ جو کی بحث ہے وہ بیان کر دی گئی ہے کہ پاکستان میں بہت سے لوگوں کو, یہ ان کے انویٹیشن لیٹر میں بھی بہت نمایاں تھا, بہت سے لوگوں کا خیال ہے, کچھ کا آرٹیکولیٹڈ کچھ کا ان آرٹیکولیٹڈ, کہ شاید اب ہم مینوفیکچرنگ کی سٹیج کو لیپ فراگ کر سکتے ہیں اور سافٹ اکانومی اور نالج اکانومی, جو آپ کے بھی سارے کی نوٹ ایڈریسز ایک سے لے کے آخر تک اسی تھیم پہ گھومتے ہیں. تو بہت سے لوگوں کا یہ خیال ہے کہ یہ مینوفیکچرنگ تو ایکچولی لیپ فراگ کی جا سکتی ہے. اس میں کچھ پیسیمزم کا بھی دخل ہے جو اس میں بہت اچھے طریقے سے بیان ہے, وہ چاہے لوڈ شیڈنگ کی وجہ سے ہو یا انرجی کی وجہ سے ہو یا انفراسٹرکچر کی وجہ سے ہو. بحث اس پہ ہونی چاہیے, لیکن انہوں نے بھی کاؤنٹر پوائنٹ لیا ہے کہ یہ ایک ایسی سٹیج نہیں ہے جس کو آپ لیپ فراگ کر لیں. دس از سم تھنگ تھرو وچ یو ہیو ٹو گو بیفور یو گو بیفور یو میک نالج اکانومی اور سافٹ اکانومی اور پوسٹ انڈسٹریل اکانومی ایز دا سورس فار یور گروتھ. اس لیے جو ڈسکشن ایس ای جیز کی وجہ سے اور اس پینل میں بھی, ایکچولی تو بہت ڈائلیوٹ کیا ہے آپ نے یہ کہہ کے کہ انڈسٹریلائزیشن اور مینوفیکچرنگ کوئی ڈسٹنگوش نہیں کیا, اس میں دو اور چیزیں ڈال دیں, اربنائزیشن اور ایس ای جی اور ہیومن ڈیولپمنٹ. میرا خیال یہ ہے, اس لیے میں مشورہ بھی اس میں آخر میں یہ لایا ہوا تھا کہ اتنا امپورٹنٹ مسئلہ ہے اس وقت, اس سب کے آخر میں انہوں نے کہا کہ دو باٹل نیکس ہیں. سب سے بڑا باٹل نیک ڈی ایف آئیز اور فائنینس کا نہ ہونا ہے. اس وقت جب فائنینس آ گیا ہے تو ہمارا اسکیپٹیسزم ہمارے انتھیوزیازم کو 10 times اوور رائڈ کر رہا ہے. جب فائنلی فائنینس اویلیبل ہو گیا ہے تو ہمارا اسکیپٹیسزم, میں چونکہ 2 سے سی پیک پہ کام کر رہا ہوں, ہمارا اسکیپٹیسزم 10 times اوور رائڈ کر رہا ہے. اور اگر پاکستان کی لیڈنگ کلاسز کو, جن کو اس بیچارے 45% دیہات کا اور 583 کے لیے کوئی درد ہونا چاہیے دل میں, اس کے لیے اپنا اسکیپٹیسزم, اس کی اپنی انا اور اپنے انٹرسٹس اور اپنی لابیز 10 times ایٹ لیسٹ اوور رائڈ کر رہی ہیں, ہو سکتا ہے کہ اس کے ٹاپ میں 20 times اوور رائڈ کر رہی ہوں. اس لیے میرا مشورہ یہ ہے کہ ہمیں کیومولیٹو ہونا چاہیے. آئی ہیڈ وشڈ دا پینل واز بلٹ آن دس rather than a fresh panel from zero. This is one of the best discussions I've ever read for Pakistan in this volume 2.5 years ago. Dusra ye ki hame communitarian hone chahiye. Maine kafi talash kiya is sare program ko, bahut gaur se padha ki Lahore School of Economics ya jo bhi koi, mujhe nahi malum ki kaun hai, and since I'm not a development economist, I don't know the groups, کہ ان کی اس پہ اوپر کوئی بلڈ ہوا یا نہیں ہوا. تو میرا خیال یہ ہے کہ ہمیں, چونکہ مینوفیکچرنگ اور ایس ایز ایز اور فائنلی انویسٹمنٹ کے لیے پیسے آ گئے ہیں, فائنلی انرجی کا پرابلم بڑی حد تک ایڈریس ہوا ہے, اب اگر انفراسٹرکچر اور انرجی کے بعد مینوفیکچرنگ نہ ہوئی تو ہم, میرا خیال ہے کہ اس انرجی کے پیسے بھی نہیں دے سکیں گے. یہ انرجی صرف گھروں میں بلب جلانے کے لیے اور ایئر کنڈیشنروں کے لیے اگر ہوئی تو ہم مزید ڈوب جائیں گے. اس لیے یہ جو سارا کچھ انفراسٹرکچر کے بھی 5 billion اور 33 billion انرجی کے, اس کے بعد اگر مینوفیکچرنگ نہ آئی اور ہمارا اسکیپٹیسزم ہی ہمیں لے ڈوبا, اس لیے ایک راؤنڈ ٹیبل میرا مشورہ ہے کہ اس پہ کروائیں اسپیشل, کم از کم جو اسی پہ فوکسڈ ہو. اور اسی طرح سے اس کے بعد تو شاید ایک دن کی ورک شاپ ہونی چاہیے جو پاکستان کے مینوفیکچرنگ سیکٹر میں ہو, اور اگر ایسا نہیں ہے تو پھر یہ بتانا چاہیے کہ مینوفیکچرنگ کے بغیر جو دوسری آپشن ہے, جو سافٹ آپشن ہے, پھر اس کے کیا پراسپیکٹس ہیں جو پائے جاتے ہیں. تھینک یو ویری مچ.
اپنے خیالات انڈسٹری اور مینوفیکچرنگ کے بارے میں اس سے ہمیں مستفید کرنے کے حوالے سے. جی, ہمارے اگلے پینلسٹ جو ہیں ان کا نام ہے اظہر ضیاءالرحمان صاحب, ان کا استقبال کیجیے. السلام
علیکم. تھینک یو ویری مچ. ڈاکٹر اجاز کے بعد کسی کے لیے بھی بولنا بہت مشکل ہوتا ہے. آئی ہوپ اٹس ناٹ I hope I stand to some extent to his to the standard that is set. I'm not an economist. I've not even read economics 101. The only relationship I have with economics is that my father was an economist and he was the founder of the PSDE back in 1980 something probably. Sorry. I'm an engineer and I'm an expert on governance. I implement governance. I've been doing that for the last 38 years in Pakistan and in more than 20 countries. There were some questions raised by Dr. Anjum earlier. Probably I've got some answers to those questions. The first question that I raised, or the first answer that I gave, is that one of our basic problems is that we don't have a culture of quality. The awareness to quality is not there. The awareness to standards is not there. The only standard that the Pakistani industry knows of is 9001, which is not a standard. It just tells that you've documented your processes. You may not be following those processes, so it's not a standard at all. It's just an eyewash. So we must have a culture of standards, culture of quality, which we don't have. And that's why our industry cannot compete with the industry around the world. The second problem is that there is no risk management at all. I am a consultant to a very large organization in Karachi, an organization which runs a critical infrastructure in Karachi. I audited them and now I'm implementing some systems there. They don't have a risk management department. They don't have a compliance management department. In a city like Karachi, in a country like Pakistan, in days like these, how can you not have risk management in a company? The third issue that I've found out is corporate governance. Corporate governance doesn't exist in most companies in Pakistan. Corporate governance codes don't exist in Pakistan. The new corporate governance law which came in this year doesn't address the industry 4.0 or that doesn't address the fourth industrial revolution issues. I've been involved in the development of the corporate governance code for South Africa. It's called King 4, and that is the most advanced corporate governance code anywhere in the world. And it's the only code anywhere in the world which deals with specifically with issues of industry 4.0. It's very specific. It tells you exactly how you deal with technology, not IT, technology as a whole. So that's something which is weak in Pakistan. The next is we've got an aging banking industry. It's aging. The systems they have are primitive. The systems they have are patchwork. They've got some core banking systems, and they would have a lot of patches on that system. And there is no governance of those patches. As a result, what has happened is that earlier this year, I was involved with the State Bank of Pakistan in developing something called technology governance framework. All the banks in Pakistan have to implement that framework. And I know, I'm working with the State Bank, most of the banks are having problems even understanding that framework. They don't have the people, they don't have the resources, they don't have the skills, they don't have the technology background to implement that framework. As a result, they cannot adopt new technology efficiently. They're coming up with good systems, good software, but that is not the solution. They are not skilled to cater to the needs of Industry 4.0. Then my next point is IT. Yes, we produce some very good software, but the IT that runs our industry, the IT that runs our banks, the IT that runs our companies is pathetic. What I mean by that? What is IT? IT is used to automate the business, right? It automates HR, it automates finance, it automates procurement, everything. But there are two departments in 99% of the organizations, not only in Pakistan but worldwide, which are not automated. Two departments. The first one is IT itself. IT itself is not automated. And the second department which is not automated is governance. Governance is not automated. As a result, when you go to a corporate secretary and ask him what happened to a decision that we made 2 years ago, he doesn't have an answer. So automation of IT and automation of corporate governance is not done, not only in Pakistan, around the world. My next point is information security. We don't have an information security standard of our own. Most of the countries, even the Gulf countries, are coming up with their own information security standards. In Pakistan, there is no awareness at all of information security. We have a pathetic law which aims at only punishing people, not improving information security. So that's my point. And my last point is that we have a misaligned education system. I think only 3 or 4 universities are geared to producing people who are really needed by the industry. Last year, I was on a consultancy assignment in Dahran with the University of Petroleum and Minerals. And I was with the civil engineering department. And they want to realign their syllabus to cater to the needs of Industry 4.0. I'm not a civil engineer, but I'm an Industry 4.0 consultant. So they want to realign their syllabus to meet the needs of Industry 4.0. So I think these 7 points are my recommendations, that something should be done on these lines if we have to survive, if we have to even save whatever little industry we have. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Azhar Zia-ur-Rehman, for inviting us with the importance of standards, risk management, and corporate governance. So that's all from the presentation about the topic from the panelist. And now in the first round, we would like our audience to share four questions.
Thank you very much. I'm Talatanra from PIDE. Referring to the presentation of Dr. Tariq Banuri on Schumpeter growth pole theories, in particular the point of concentration of income. You know, the controversy about the growth pole theory is the concentration of income. I would like to add that, you know, there has been concentration of income in Pakistan, which is on the rise. But the bad news is that, you know, provincial inequality, you know, inter-provincial inequality is also on the rise. Over the last, you know, the development policies that we have pursued over the last two decades has increased the provincial, inter-provincial inequality. It is almost doubled. And there is a fear that, you know, the SEZs would like, you know, will contribute more towards the concentration of income and will contribute towards the disparity and inter-provincial inequality. Thank you.
Assalamu alaikum, sir. I'm a student of MPhil Economics. My name is Muhammad Ibrahim and I belong to District Nushera. Actually, sir, as you mentioned, the Rashakai economic zone, but a few days earlier, I read an article in Dawn, which stated that Chinese government is reluctant to invest in that region. So I want to say that we have served in the past in the industry sector of Pakistan, then we were struck by the Bhutto's nationalization policies and labor unions. Well, we have the industries like Churat Cement Factory and Asprey Cement Factory, and we have industries of in pharmaceutical sector. So we want to serve, sir. And if we are stripped off again, the opportunity, so it will cost us too much. So, sir, what would the Center of Excellence of CPEC would do for us in this regard? Because if they do not invest there, so it would be not good for us, sir, please.
I guess my question would be addressed to those in government and concerned with CPEC. Was anything like the present discussion held before these SEZs were identified and finalized?
My name is Asnan. I am from Center of Excellence CPEC. Sir, my question is industry 4.0, especially you are a consultant, is that we have even the current industry automated. So we don't comply with 3.0. And in CPEC, there is also a lot of manufacturing industry coming in. So what do you understand about this? How will this framework implement or how will it adapt if we talk about the modern industrial revolution?
Thanks for the questions. And now the first question refers to Dr. Tariq Banuri, sir.
Well, it's a comment rather than a question. But the main thing is that what the theory that I was trying to propound was gives a framework. And it's a framework that enables us both to kind of understand the process and understand its limitations, and also think about how to address them. So one way in which one thinks is, you know, you think of a growth pole as almost like a peak, and then you ask yourself, how does this spread? So if you think of a growth pole where it's like this, that means all the profit is concentrated here and then nothing else, right? It's like a copper mine where, or a diamond mine where you have poverty everywhere and then just a pole, then you know that you have a problem. But if you have a pole where the terrain is flat, then that's the kind of solution that we want. Now the question one needs to ask is, how does one approach this issue? How does one make this more flat as a terrain? What kind of financing system? In other words, is the financing only going towards larger investment, or they are available for smaller investments as well? Is the technology spillover effect making itself known, or is it remaining concentrated in a few hands? And there, all of these things are actually subject to policy intervention. So the framework can only help us understand. It doesn't give the outcome. It just tells us, you know, what are the relationships between different variables. And then if you want to manipulate a variable, what do you need to do? So I think that this framework does provide some of those ideas, and we can perhaps move upon them if we so wish.
Thank you very much. And regarding the second question, which is that Chinese are reluctant to invest in the Pakistani SEZs, might not be true because of the reason that Chinese have already visited twice in order to share their special economic zones experiences of China with the Pakistani business community, Pakistani developers, Pakistani policy makers. And they have done it in Islamabad, Karachi, and Lahore. And the other dimension is that in the last JCC, which is 7th JCC held on 21st of November 2017 in Pakistan, Chinese have already seriously took over the feasibility studies of 9 special economic zones which are developing under the CPEC umbrella. And now they are seriously working on coming back to their opinions on the SEZs so that they could start developing those SEZs and then try to colonate the industries in those SEZs. So Center of Excellence is already working out on the latent comparative advantages and endowments of those SEZs in order to give some thoughts to our knowledge partners and to the BOI, Board of Investment, which is actually looking after these SEZs, so that they can brand those SEZs, they can well market those SEZs to Chinese and other investors. Thank you. And regarding the third question, which is SEZs identification and finalization discussions, I would like to request the chair, Mr. Naeem Zamindar. Okay, so that would be responded in the closing comments. And the fourth question was about Industry 4.0, whether it is feasible at this stage to implement or not. I would like to refer this question to Mr. Azhar Zia-ur-Rehman, who is expert on this.
Thank you very much. It's not a matter of should we or when should we. It's a matter of life and death. If you don't, you're wiped out. So if you really boil down Industry 4.0 requirements to the smallest level, it comes to 3 requirements only, and that's very simple. Number one is governance. You must have very efficient governance at the corporate level, at the government level, corporate level, and at the technology level. So because Industry 4.0 requires about more than 10 different types of technologies which have to be governed in synchronism. So governance is the first requirement. Second requirement is quality. You must be very conscious of quality. You must follow standards. So we have to have some law under which the industry and the organizations have to comply with standards, international standards. And the third requirement is agility. Our organizations, our industries have to be very agile. They have to shift their production capacity, their thinking, their products overnight. And so unless you've got good governance, unless you've got, you follow the standards and quality, you cannot be agile. And once you are agile, you can compete with anybody around the world. Do I make sense?
Thank you very much. And now I would like to request the chair of this session, Mr. Naeem Zamindar, Chairman, Board of Investment, to enlighten us with his closing remarks.
Ji, salaam alaikum. So, دیکھیں یہ ایس ای زیز کا ایکٹ 2016 میں آیا تھا رائٹ اور اس کے بعد 7 ایس ای زیز وا اسٹیبلشڈ اینڈ لائک سم آف دا اسپیکر سیٹ دا چیلنج ہیز بین دیٹ دے ہیو ناٹ ریئلی بین کالونائزڈ ریئل اسٹیٹ ہیز بین سولڈ اینڈ باٹ اینڈ دیر آل سولڈ رائٹ بٹ دا نمبر آف انڈسٹریز اوور دیر ہیز بین ویری ویری فیو سو دا چیلنج از اینڈ دیٹ یو نو وی نیڈ ٹو گیٹ اٹ رائٹ دس ٹائم وی ٹیکنگ رائڈنگ دا اپرچونٹی آف سی پیک. In the CPEC early harvest, the energy issue has been mostly addressed. The baseline infrastructure has been set up. The FTAs are in place, right? To really create the GSP Plus is there. In the GSP Plus in Europe, we have only 5% market share of the textile market. We could easily double it if you want to, right? So really, in terms of the market access is available, the infrastructure is in place. The CPEC is a pull opportunity like Dr. Tariq Banuri was mentioning. As Shumta said, where China, right, China has moved from a low income country, right, over the last 30 years from $200 GDP per capita to about 8,000. It's been amazing, phenomenal growth, right? And now it wants to move from middle income country to a upper income country. In this stage, they want to move the economy to away from manufacturing, and they have in their planning, they've assumed that over the next 20 years, about 85 million jobs will be moved out of China to other countries. Now, what share of that does Pakistan get is up to us. And we're competing with a lot of other markets like Bangladesh, Vietnam, even Africa. So the whole idea with these new preferred special economic zones, which we went gone through a very long identification process where we engaged all the provinces, we engaged consultants, right, to figure out what are the factors in those areas that are available that we could use as competitive advantage. We've thought about global value chains and how we could fit into those global value chains to be a part of this new opportunity. So this is a very large opportunity, and we have to now convert it into a meaningful, right, reindustrialization of Pakistan. So the possibility is there, the work has to be done, not enough work has been done. Our community of economists, of thinkers, of strategists need to do that work. Still very early days, and the marketing has started. And some of these industries we don't even understand, right? I just told this morning, for example, that a delegation of 150 universities is coming from China to Pakistan starting January, right? So they also see the economic opportunity. They're also looking for markets. Pakistan is the fifth largest country in the world right now. And the next, by 30 years, is going to be the third largest. It's a huge market opportunity as it moves from a GDP, right, of about $300 billion to about, you know, over $1 trillion. China is going to move from $10 trillion to $40 trillion over the next, I'm not sure whether 20 or 30 years, right? So that is a huge market opportunity. The speakers mentioned agro-based industries. China imports $100 billion worth of agricultural products, right? We could easily feed into that, especially as they move from middle income to upper income. Their desire for Asian foods, etc., variety, is going to go up, and we can play into that value chain. Also, you know, we assume that China just exports. China imports a lot. From India, it right now currently imports $70 billion worth of goods. $70 billion worth of goods. Those same goods can be manufactured in Pakistan as well. Again, our challenge had been energy, lack of energy, lack of infrastructure, and lack of law and order, right? Because of the conflict, as one of our speakers said, you know, you need DFIs and finance available. Finance didn't come into this country. So as the Board of Investment, one of the big initiatives that we are driving is towards funding entrepreneurs, local entrepreneurs, right? Getting venture capital funds to come in, private equity funds to come in, help scale up these, you know, anybody who's got the competency to help them scale up, or new entrepreneurs to come and grow businesses of the future. Like he said, the fourth industrial revolution is upon us. And we need to be able to back our entrepreneurs to be able to play in that opportunity. Pakistan has great challenges. I used to be part of the telecom industry, right? In the telecom industry, we saw that for many years, very, very slow growth, and we had very difficult, it was a very small market. Then suddenly, in 2003, 2004, it just started taking off. From 2 million subscribers to 100 million in 5 years. The same thing is going to happen to Pakistan. I think we need to become very optimistic about Pakistan. All our challenges are also great opportunities. Our education gap, half our kids don't go to school. This problem can be solved, right? The infrastructure, the networks are available, the technologies to solve that problem are there. We need entrepreneurs to go out there and actually make it happen. Every problem of ours is really an opportunity. And it needs, the biggest opportunity is that we've got a very young population, right? Average age is 21. And a lot of them are very, we are naturally entrepreneurial, right? Hum kehte na, hum jugadu log hai. That's why Pakistan should be branded as an entrepreneurial country. We just need to be able to unleash this force. And this is one of the areas that we as the Board of Investment are now thinking putting our focus on. And we need to leapfrog, right? The whole opportunity of blockchain technologies, artificial intelligence, this could be a huge advantage for us. In a country where infrastructure does not exist, we will use these technologies to leapfrog. And that's why a progressive mindset is required. I am very, very confident, and I've seen the people, the conversations are going on, right? I know that a lot of it is not heard, because when you're in that stage, but I think over the next 3 years, you will see an explosion of opportunity. Pakistan is going to be the center of global opportunity, and people are seeing it. We're seeing lines of investors coming in. Now, the problem is, a lot of our speakers said, is our challenge of getting our own act together. One of the biggest challenges are people who are coming to us, border investment, is that, you know, there's a lot of bureaucracy, getting approvals, etc., is nightmare. So special economic zones actually addresses that, where we'll have one stop shop for being able to get all those matters addressed. So we're trying to address it. We're trying to get the finance behind it. So there is a method behind the madness. Things are being addressed. They will take a little longer. I think the right mindset is behind it. And let's be optimistic about Pakistan. Let's believe in ourselves and make it happen. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Naeem Zamindar Saab. And this is now leading us towards the end of the session, titled Industrial Development, Job Creation, Special Economic Zones and Urban Development. I would like to thank the chairman, the panelists, the audience for making this session comfortable and successful, and a forum for sharing the knowledge. Thank you very much. And over to Dr. Khalid.
Thank you very much, Dr. Shahin. So we had a very enlightening discussion from the panelists and from the floor. Definitely they're going to take away messages. I'm going to now proudly announce that the last year's paper proceeding volume of the PDR has been launched. That is now available with the stall outside. Those who have contributed in the last year's conference can take their copy, and the PSD members. It is complimentary for them. And this is just to show that this year also, inshallah, the paper presentations and the remarks which has been made from this forum would also be presented in the form of this publication. Okay, so I have now closed this session officially. Now I would like to request the chairperson of this session, Mr. Naeem Zamindar, to please come forward to hand over the souvenirs to the panelists for this session. First souvenir was to be given to Dr. Tariq Banuri, but he had to leave early. So I would like to request Ma'am Anjum Asad Amin to please come forward and receive their moment. This is a small token of appreciation for sparing time for us. Thank you very much, ma'am. Professor Aliya, Dr. Aliya. Thank you, ma'am. Next,